B'siyata d'shmaya, we're going to learn Rosh Hashanah Daf Yud Ches. We're going to start two lines from the top of the Omid. Ugzar din de'yochid. And this is taking us back to the topic we learned on the previous Daf, whether after a decree has been set and decreed upon an individual, can that be overturned or not? Rabbi Yochanan said on the first wide line on Daf Yud Zayin Omid Beis that tshuva can tear up even a gzar din, a decree. And the Gemara established that that's only talking about when there's a gzar din against the tzibur, the community, the public, and they do tshuva, then they can tear up the gzar din, the decree. But a private person cannot. And now the Gemara is saying that this concept is actually a machlekes tanoim. Tanoi hi, the tanya we learned in a brisa. Hoya Reb Meir Omer, shnayim she'olu lemito, v'chol yon shove, two people who became sick with the same illness. V'chein shnayim she'olu legardoim lidoin, or two people that were standing, that went to the tribunal where they were being judged, and they could well have been sentenced to death. V'dinon shove, and both of them had the same case against them. Ze yorad v'ze lo yorad, one of the sick people recovered and the other one didn't. Ze nitzel v'ze lo nitzel, one recovered and got saved from the tribunal and the other one not. Mipnei ma ze yorad v'ze lo yorad, ze nitzel v'ze lo nitzel, what would be the determining factor as to why one person got saved and the other one not? Says the Gemara, says Reb Meir, one, they both davened. One of them, their tefillah was answered, and the other one not. Why was one of them answered and the other one not? One of them davened a complete tefillah with full concentration and humility and all the other conditions that a tefillah needs. And he was nene, he was answered. V'ze lo yispalil tefillah shleima. And the other one did not daven a whole tefillah. Lo yinene, and that's why he wasn't answered. That was Reb Meir's opinion. Reb Elozo says, no. Kan koidem gzar din, kan la'achar gzar din. That before the gzar din, if the decree has not yet been made and he became sick, then he can overturn his fortune and he can be saved from the tribunal. He can get saved and healed from his illness. But kan la'achar gzar din, once there was already a decree that was set in place, then they cannot be overturned. Rabbi Yitzchok Omar, Rabbi Yitzchok says, yofe tza'oko le'odom, the crying out to Hashem is beneficial for a person, bein koidem gzar din, bein la'achar gzar din. But even also before the gzar din and even after the gzar din. Now it's clear here that according to Reb Elozo, after gzar din, the tefillahs cannot be niskabel, which conforms with what we saw in the sugya on Daf Yud Zayin Amud Beis. However, there's a discussion in the Rishonim whether Reb Meir or Reb Yitzchok or both, but it seems that both of them entertain the idea that the fact that there was already a gzar din is not yet the final word. If it's a tefillah shleima, it can be answered. And Rabbi Yitzchok says, even after the gzar din, the crying out is beneficial, at least on some level. And so there's Rabbeinu Chananel here and the Ritva who discuss exactly who the second Tana is, who's actually arguing with Rabbi Loza as to whether after a gzar din one can still turn around the gzar din, whether the Gemara meant Rabbi Meir or Rabbi Yitzchok, but they both could entertain that idea. Continues the Gemara. Ugzar din de tzibur mi mekar. We saw before, Rabbi Yochanan said this, that even after a decree has been made against a tzibur, against the public, against the community, one can tear up the gzar din if one does tshuva. And the Gemara is saying, is that so? V'hokosuv echad oimer. There's one posuk, this is a posuk in Yirmiyah. The posuk says, kapsi meiro'o libeich. You should wash your heart from evil. Uchsiv, and there's another pasuk that says, ki im techabsi, even if you will wash beneser, with a type of soap or type of detergent or something called neser, v'sarbi loch boiris, and you'll use soap, nichtom avoineich lefonoi, your stain will remain, the stain of your sins will remain before me, Nu'um Hashem Elikim, says Hashem. So in one pasuk it says that the the sin can be washed away, and the other pasuk says it will not be washed away. My love, can we not assume, says the Gemara, kan koidim gzaradin, that before the gzaradin, one can wash away the sin, and then there won't be a gzaradin. Kan la'achar gzaradin, but once the gzaradin has already been done, then one cannot wash away the sin, and the punishment will be met. So you see here clearly that in the case that there was a gzaradin, then there's no way of rubbing it out, of rubbing away the averus. And this seems to contradict what we saw before, that regarding the tzibur, a gzaradin can be torn up. Says the Gemara, loy, idi ve'idi le'achar gzaradin. Both psukim are referring to after the gzaradin. Of course, technically speaking and intrinsically speaking, even after a gzaradin on a tzibur, one can overturn the decree and one can get saved. However, there's a certain type of decree that's so strong that even a tzibur cannot overturn it. When the decree is made with an oath, then one cannot wipe it away. Kan begzaradin she'eini meishvua, but a regular decree that does not have an oath with it, it can be overturned, providing that it's from the tzibur. It's on the tzibur. Kedur of Shmuel bar Ami, the Omer of Shmuel bar Ami, the Omri lo Omer of Shmuel bar Nachmeni, the discussion which Shmuel this was, Omer Rabbi Yechanan, the name of Rabbi Yechanan, minayin legzaradin she'yesh ima yishvua, she'eino nikra. What's the source that a decree that is accompanied with an oath, that it cannot be torn up? Shenemer, it says in the Pasuk, in Shmuel, Lochein nishbati leveis Eli, I swore to the household of Eli, to the family of Eli, im yiskapir avoin beis Eli, that the averus of the home of Eli, the children of Eli, will not be forgiven, bezevach ubamincha, even with bringing korbonis ad oilam forever. And we know, we're going to see soon, that the descendants of Eli HaKohen were punished, that they all die very young. And so you see there, that since Hashem says Nishbati, it was a decree of Im Yiskaper, I'm not going to forgive them, even with Zevach U'Mincha, that since it was with a Shvua, therefore it's never going to be overturned. And that's the source, says Rav Shmuel Bar Ami, or Rav Shmuel Bar Nachmeni, in the name of Rabbi Yechanan. Omar Rava. Rava now said, from the fact that the Pasuk in Shmuel says that Hashem said that I'm not going to forgive the descendants of Eli even if they repent with Zevach U'Mincha, that's only with Zevach U'Mincha that they're not going to be forgiven and the decree is going to stay in its place. Avol Miskapir, but they can be atoned, but Torah. If they are engaged and completely given over to Torah, then it will help them. Abaye Omar, Abaye says, "B'zevach u'mincha eini miskapir, avol miskapir b'Torah u'b'gmilas chasadim." With zevach u'mincha on its own, they will not be atoned, but Torah together with kind deeds, gmilas chasadim, then they will be atoned. Rabba v'Abaye, and there's a discussion here whether this is Rava. Some have the version here that it's Rava. And there's a question on this that we find that Rava wasn't a Kohen. Maybe he was a descendant of Eli from his mother. And others, Agoras here, they have the version Rabba, and then it's referring to Rabba Bar Nachmeni. But either way, Rabba va'Abaya midabes Eli ka'osu. They were descendants of Eli. Rabba da osak ba'Torah, Rabba who was primarily engaged in Torah learning and less with Gemilas Chasadim, Chayar Boin Shnin. He lived 40 years, which is approximately 20 years longer than the rest of the descendants of Eli HaKohen did. Abaye da osek b'Torah u'b'gemilas chasadim, Abaye that was engaged not only in Torah but also in gemilas chasadim, chayo shitin shnin, he lived 60 years. Tanu Rabbanon, mishpocha achas hayisa b'Yerushalayim, there was a family in Yerushalayim, shehoyu meiseo meisin b'nei yudches shona, that they would die when they were 18 years old. They came and told Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, what should we do here? Everybody is dying so young. Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai told this family, maybe you are from the family of Eli HaKohen. That against them, it was said in the Pasuk in Shmuel Aleph, V'chol marbis beischo yomusu anoshim, that all those raised in your home are going to die as young men. L'chu v'isku b'Torah, go and study Torah, v'chiu, and you'll live. Holchu v'osku b'Torah, they went and became engaged in Torah, v'choyu, and indeed they stopped dying so young. V'hoyu koirin oisa, mishpachas Rabban Yochanan, they would call this family the family of Rabbi Yochanan, al shmoi, in the name of Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, who gave them this advice, and thanks to his advice, they survived into adulthood. Continues the Gemara. Omer of Shmuel bar Inya Mishmei de Rav. It was said in the name of Rav. Minayin legzar din shel tzibur. How do we know? What would be the source that a decree against the tzibur she'einoi nechtam, that it is never gets sealed? Says the Gemara, einoi nechtam. Is that true? They never get sealed. V'oksiv, we saw before when it's talking that the pasuk the Gemara brought earlier on at the top of the Amud. It says that ki'im techabsi. Even if you're going to wash, b'neser, b'tarbi l'choboiris, nichtom avoynich lefonai, the stains of your sins are going to remain before me, no'um Hashem Elokim. So you see that it's sealed, and that's why it's going to stay eternally. Elo, says the Gemara, no. What Rav meant to say was that, af al gav shenechtam nikra. What Rav meant to say was, you want to know the source that regarding a decree against the tzibur, even when it's been written and sealed and there's been a chasima, nikra, nonetheless it can still be torn up. Shenemar, because it says in the pasuk, Kashem Elokeinu b'chol koreinu elav, that the pasuk goes, Kimigoi godil, there's no nation as great, Ashelo Elokim, that is close to Hashem, Kroivim elav, close to it, Kashem Elokeinu, like the Hashem, our God, b'chol koreinu elav, in all our, whenever we call out to Hashem, then he's there. V'oksiv, but this seems to contradict another pasuk that says in Yeshaya, dirshu Hashem, you should seek Hashem, behimotzei, when he can be found, kara'uhu b'yosei kariv, call to him when he's close. So you see that he's not always available. He can't always be used, so to speak, and come to our help. Says the Gemara, no, hosom b'yochid, that when it speaks about an individual, then there are special times when those times we know, find Hashem, seek Hashem, he can be found, and he'll answer your tefillas. V'hocha b'tzibur. However, when it comes to the public there, it says, b'chol koreinu elov, that whenever you call out to Hashem, then he's there to answer our tefillas. And that's the source of what Rav says, that even though it was nechtam, nikra, it can get torn up. And the pasuk that says, nechtam avoynech lefonai, we already saw before. That's talking about if it was with a shvua, with an oath, is different. Says the Gemara, b'yochid emas, when it says that the individuals, an individual person, can seek Hashem, behimotzei, when he can be found, and that's not always, when can Hashem be found? Omar Rabbi Baravua, Eilu Asora Yomim Shabin Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippurim. These are the 10 days between the beginning of Rosh Hashanah and the end of Yom Kippur. Those days, even an individual has the same power as that of a tzibur in this context. And when they turn to Hashem, then Hashem is going to answer their tefillas. And this is what in other places is referred to in the Yerushalmi, calls these days by the term that we know them, Aseres Yemei Tshuva. Continues the Gemara. There's a pasuk in Shmuel, Vayhi ka aseres hayomim, and it was after 10 days, Vayigoyf Hashem es novol vayomis, and Hashem struck novol and he died. Which means that really novol was deserving of dying 10 days earlier. Hashem waited 10 days. So asks the Gemara, Yud Yomim, my avidatayu, what was the significance of waiting to punish novol these 10 days? Omer Vyud Omer Rav, Keneged Eser Legimois Shenosa Novol Lavde David. David HaMelech had sent to him 10 servants, and he was kind enough to give them a meal to feed each of them, and against those 10, or as a reward for those 10 meals that he gave, his punishment was delayed by 10 days. Omer of Nachman Omer Rav Baravua, Eilu Asara Yomim Shabin Rosh Hashanah L'Yom HaKippurim, Hashem waited for him for the 10 days of Aseres Yemei Tshuva, that he should do tshuva. He didn't do tshuva, and after 10 days were over, Hashem gave him the punishment that he deserved. Continues the Gemara, B'Rosh Hashanah Kol Boye Oilam Oivrim Lafonov Kuvnei Meroin, And this takes us back to the Mishnah that we saw on the top of Daf Tezayin Amud Aleph, that on Rosh Hashanah, all the men of the world passed before Hashem, k'bnei moroin, shenemar, as it says, hayotzer yachad libom, that Hashem fashioned their hearts together, hamevin el kol maseim, and understands all their deeds. So now the Gemara is going to discuss my k'bnei moroin. On Rosh Hashanah we are judged like b'nei moroin. What is b'nei moroin? Says the Gemara, Hocha here in Bavel, Tirgumu k'bnei imrona. The word moroin is from the word in Aramaic of imrona, which is lambs. And when lambs are counted to take meiser, we know there's meiser behema, the lambs all go through a very narrow entrance or exit, and where only one can go at a time. And in order that one should be able to count them accurately. And so too on Rosh Hashanah, we get counted, we stand before Hashem one at a time. That's how they explained the B'nai Meroin, this Mishnah in Bavel. Resh Lakish, who was in Eretz Yisrael, Omar, K'mailois B'nai Meroin. This is talking about the elevated paths of the base Meroin, not B'nai Meroin, the base Meroin. And this was a place where they had some very, very narrow paths with a very deep decline on either side, and they could only walk one behind each other, and they could not walk next to each other. And this again is a term used for being judged individually, each person on his own. Omer Biuda Mashmuel, a third explanation, Kechayolo is like the soldiers shall base David, and Meroin is a term of authority of Morus, and the soldiers are called the Meroin, and when soldiers go out, then they get counted. When they go out to war, they get counted one by one. Again, this is an explanation the common denominator between these three explanations is that on Rosh Hashanah we get counted individually. Each person gets counted for his unique deeds, gets judged for who he is individually. Omer Rabbi Bar Barchon, Omer Rabbi Yechanon, v'kulon niskorin b'skira achas. Even though a person is judged individually on his own, nonetheless Hashem glances at everybody all at once. Omer of Nachman b'Yitzchok, afanan nami tanina. We also saw this in the Braisa, that the Pasuk says, and this is actually the Pasuk the Mishnah brings to prove that we are judged one by one. From the same Pasuk we see that Hashem glances at everybody all together. The Pasuk says, Hayotzer yachad libom, he created their hearts together, hamevin el kol maseim, and he understands all their deeds. Maika Omar, what does it mean, Hayotzer yachad libom? Ilei mehochikoma, does it mean, deborinhu lekula alma, that he created all the hearts of all the people, he created all everybody, that he combined, he united all the hearts of all the people that he created? Could it be that's what the Pasuk means? We see that that's not the case. We see that different people have different hearts, have different feelings, no two people have the same hearts. Elolav, it must be Hochi Ka'omar. What the Pasuk means to say is, Hayotzer, that the creator of all the hearts is Yachad, Roye Yachad Libom. He views, he sees, he glances at all the hearts, even though each one is unique, but he glances at all of them Yachad at once. And that is the source that Niskorin, Kulon Niskorin Beskira Achas. Umevin El Kol Maseim. The words Umevin El Kol Maseim, this takes us back to what the Mishnah saw in this Pasuk, that Hashem judges each and every person individually based on his own unique journey, his own deeds, what he has done. That's how Rabbeinu Chananel seems to explain this. Continues the next Mishnah. Al Shisha Chadoshim Ashluchin Yitzin. We're going back to the main topic, the theme of this perek, and that is the halachas of Kiddush HaChodesh. Back in the day, in the time of the Beis HaMikdosh, and even in the time after the Beis HaMikdosh, then they used to determine the first day of the month with Kiddush HaChodesh. Witnesses would come and say, we saw the new moon, and then the Beis Din would say, Mekudosh. Whether they have to say or not is going to be a discussion later in the Gemara, but they would be Mekadosh, the Chodesh, it would be Beis Din that would determine when Rosh Chodesh is, and when could Rosh Chodesh be. So we know that in astronomical terms, a lunar month is exactly 29 days and 12 hours and Tovshin Tzadik Gimel Chalokim, we don't need to go into the very fine details, but it's approximately 29 and a half days. When is Rosh Chodesh? So Rosh Chodesh could be on day 30, which means that the day 30 after the beginning of the month is the first day of the next month, which means that the month that's just finished only had 29 days in. That's called a month which is Chosar. And then you've got a month which is Moleh, which means day 30 belongs to the previous month and day 31 becomes the first day of the next month. So if witnesses come on day 30 to say that we saw the new moon, then day 30 becomes Rosh Chodesh. If they didn't come, then day 31 becomes Rosh Chodesh. And people didn't know when the Beis Din would make Rosh Chodesh. It depends on the witnesses coming. So all the people who are not living inside the Beis HaMikdash in the Beis Din where they determined the month, how would they know when Rosh Chodesh was? And if you don't know when Rosh Chodesh is, how do you know when the Yomim Tovim are? Pesach is the 15th of Nisan, but you don't know when that is if you don't know when the 1st of Nisan is, etc. So what did they do? They would send messengers out from the Beis Din to tell everybody when Rosh Chodesh was. Now, did they trouble these messengers every single month to go to all the places all over up and down the country and beyond to tell them about when Rosh Chodesh was? No, not every month, because not every month had a Yom Tov in it. Not every month it was necessary to know exactly what day of the month it was. So the Mishnah says, Al Shisha Chadoshim, of the 12 months in the year, 6 of them, Hashluchim Yoitzim, the messengers would go out. Al Nisan, and on Rosh Chodesh Nisan, the month of Nisan, they would go out Mipnei HaPesach, from Pesach, and that's why immediately, as soon as they made whichever day was Rosh Chodesh Nisan, as soon as they determined when Rosh Chodesh Nisan was, the messengers would go out and would disperse as far as they could get until Pesach. Obviously, besides for Shabbos, they wouldn't travel. All the other days they would go till Pesach to let as many people as possible know when the real Pesach is. Those people who didn't know, they would keep 2 days because they don't know. That's where the concept of 2 days Yom Tov comes from in Chutz Loretz. Al Av, the month of Av, Mipnei Atainis, Tisha B'Av, you have to know when the 9th of Av is. So for people to know when that is, they would send out all the 8 days between Rosh Chodesh and Tisha B'Av, besides for Shabbos, they would go and tell as many people as far as they could when Rosh Chodesh was, so that they would know when Tisha B'Av is. Al Elul, Mipnei Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah is the first day of Tishri. To know exactly when Rosh Hashanah was, the Rosh Hashanah itself, it's too late, because the day that they were Mekadosh, the Chodesh of Tishri, that is the day of Rosh Hashanah. We discussed this at length in Maseches Beitzah already. So how would people know when Rosh Hashanah is? They would tell everybody when Rosh Chodesh Elul is, and most months, most years, the month of Elul was only 29 days, so they knew that day 30, that is going to be the day of Rosh Hashanah, until Mitzvah. People should know that. They would go around and tell people when Rosh Chodesh Elul was. And there's a discussion here in the Rishonim and in the Achronim. Do we not know that everywhere they would keep 2 days Rosh Hashanah? And this is a discussion here in Tosfos and in other Mefarshim. We don't need to go into that now. Al Tishri, that once they knew when exactly Rosh Chodesh Tishri was, even though Tishri was assumed to be exactly day 30 after Rosh Chodesh Elul, but nonetheless, there was always that chance that there was 30 days in Elul, very rare, and then the Rosh Chodesh Tishri was on the 31st day after Rosh Chodesh Elul. So after Rosh Hashanah, when they knew exactly when Rosh Chodesh Tishri was, then they would go, the messengers would go out, Mipnei Takonos HaMoedos, because of the other Yomim Tovim. Because even though they could rely on the general years that the first of Tishri was 30 days after Rosh Chodesh Elul, but they would be nervous, what's with Yom Kippur, what's with Sukkos, and people wanted to know exactly when Rosh Chodesh Tishri was, and therefore the messengers would go out. Al Kislev, the month of Kislev, they would go out, Mipnei Chanukah, on the 25th of Kislev is Chanukah, they wanted to know when the first of Kislev was. Val Ador Mipnei Purim, month of Ador because of Purim. Ukushahoyo Beis HaMikdash Kayim. And from here you see that this Mishnah is talking about in the time when there was no Beis HaMikdash. It's going to have relevance in the Gemara soon. But the Mishnah is saying, and Keshehoya Beis HaMikdash Kayim, when the Beis HaMikdash was still standing, then Yoytzin Afal Iyar, they would go out also the month of Iyar, Mipnei Pesach Kotten, because of what we know as Pesach Sheni, the people that were Tomei or too far away from the Beis HaMikdash on the 14th of Nisan and couldn't do the Korban Pesach, they had the opportunity of doing the Korban Pesach on the 14th of Iyar. So in the time of the Beis HaMikdash, which is when they would have Korbanos, then the messengers would go out for the month of Iyar as well. Says the Gemara, V'lifku nami atamuz v'teves. Why don't the messengers go out in the month of Tammuz and Teves also, in the same way as they did in Av? Why did they go out in Av? Because of Tisha B'Av. In Tammuz you've got the fast of Tammuz. In Teves you have the fast of Teves. Why did they not go out then? Answers the Gemara, D'omer of Chono bar Bizna, Omer of Shimon Chasida, Maidichsiv. It says in the Pasuk, Koyomar Hashem Tzvokos, Hashem said, Tzoyim Horovi, V'tzoyim HaChamishi, V'tzoyim HaShvi, V'tzoyim HaAsiri. In these 4 months of the year, there is a fast day. The fourth month, the fifth month, the seventh month, and the tenth month. We'll soon see what they are. Yiyeh Leveis Yehuda L'Sasein U'L'Simcha. It's a fast day which is going to be for joy and for happiness. U'L'Moyadim Toivim V'Emes V'Hashalom Ehovu. That's what it says in the Pasuk. So the Gemara says, Koru Leitzoim, you're calling them a fast day. V'kori Leitzas and V'simchan, you're calling them days of joy and happiness. Well, are they not a contradiction? So says the Gemara, Bizman sheyesh shalom, in the time that there's peace, that's when they're going to be days of joy and happiness, and it's going to be also to give hespedim, to eulogize people on those days, and it's also to fast on those days. Ein shalom, in the days when there isn't peace, same. Indeed, those 4 days are going to be kept as fast days. So we see here clearly, this is not an answer of the Gemara. I made a mistake before. This is the question of the Gemara, that you see here, that there's a fast day, not only in Av, but also, we'll soon see exactly where it's written in the Pasuk, but also in Tammuz and also in Teves. So why did the messengers not go out then? Answers the Gemara, Omer of Papa, Hachik Omer. As follows. Bizman sheyesh shalom, that means Papa is rediscovering, re-going back to the contradiction. Are these days fast days or happy days? Bizman sheyesh shalom, in the time when there's peace, yiyu l'sason l'simcha. They're not fast days. They're days of joy and happiness, as we saw before. Yesh gezeiras malchus, when there's gezeiras shmad, when the goyim are trying to make people turn away from Yiddishkeit, then in those days, and only then, tzoyim, then there's a chiyuv to fast on those days. But ein gezeiras malchus, if there's no such decrees against Yiddishkeit, ve'ein sholim, but it's not a time particularly of sholim, which is most years, most of the time, then rotzu misanin. If they want to fast, they're allowed to. Rotzu ein misanin. And if they want, they don't have to fast. And since it's optional to fast on those days, therefore they did not trouble the messengers to go out and tell people exactly when Tammuz and Teves was, because in any case, the fast days in those times, in the times of the Amiroim, in the times of the Tanoim, were optional. Nowadays, it's already been accepted as a chiyuv. Then you can't say, if I want, I'm not fasting. But back in the time then, it wasn't yet as widely accepted as today, and therefore they did not trouble the messengers to go around. Asks the Gemara, Ihochi Tisha B'Av Nami? What's the difference between Tammuz and Teves and Tisha B'Av? And the Mishnah says on Av they did go out because of Tisha B'Av. Omer of Papa Shani Tisha B'Av, Papa says Tisha B'Av is different. Hoyel v'huchpulu b'itzoris, since there was double and more than doubles amount of challenges and pain and trouble that started on Tisha B'Av. Both Beis HaMikdash got destroyed on Tisha B'Av, and therefore that day is very important that everybody fasts, and therefore the messengers would go out to make sure people knew exactly when Tisha B'Av was. Da'omar mar. But Tisha B'Av Chorav Abayis Bereshoina Ubishnia, that on Tisha B'Av both the first Beis HaMikdash and the second Beis HaMikdash got destroyed. V'nilkada Beitar V'nechrasha Ha'ir, and the city of Beitar was conquered, and Yerushalayim was Nechrasha, it was plowed, and therefore it was particularly harsh day Tisha B'Av, and therefore it was very important for everybody to fast then, and that's why the messengers would go out. Continues the Gemara Tanya. Omer Reb Shimon, Reb Shimon says, Arba dvarim hoyer Reb Akiva deirish. My Rebbe, Reb Akiva, in four different psukim, he would explain them one way. Va'ani ein deirish k'moisoi. And I, even though I'm a disciple of his, but I would learn the psukim differently. And one of those three are the ones we're mentioning now, one of those four, and the other three of those four are mentioned in other places, in Chazal, in Tosefta, in Sifri, and is not discussed here. What is that? Is this very pasuk in Zechariah that we just brought, that it says in the pasuk that there's a concept of Tzoyma Ravi'i, Tzoyma Chamishi, Tzoyma Shvi'i, and Tzoyma Asiri. We have to know what is this alluding to. So when I read the pasuk, I said that these are the numbers of the months, starting from Nisan. So Tzoyma Ravi'i is the month of Tammuz, Tzoyma Chamishi is the month of Av, Tzoyma Shvi'i is the month of Tishri, and Tzoyma Asiri is going to be the month of Teves. But what's going on here? Let's try and understand this. So Reb Shimon said as follows, that Reb Akiva would say, Tzoyma Ravi'i Zutes B'Tammuz, the ninth of Tammuz is a fast day. Sheboy Huvka Ha'ir, that was the day that Yerushalayim was breached. Shenemer, as it says in the Pasuk, in Yirmiyah, that Baravi'i B'Tisho L'Chodesh, in the ninth day of the fourth month of the year, in Tammuz, V'Yechezak Arav, the famine became very critical, Ba'ir in the city, V'loihoyo lechem la'am ha'oret, and the people of the land had nothing to eat, V'tiboka ha'ir, and the city was breached. V'amai kori le'ravi, why is it called the Ravi? Ravi lechadoshim is the fourth month, Nisan i'asivan tamuz. Okay, that's the Tzoyim ha'ravi. What's Tzoyim ha'chamishi? Zeh tisha ba'av, it's the ninth of Av, sheboy nisraf beis elokeinu, the Hashem's home, so to speak, got burnt. V'amai kori le'chamishi, why is it called the fast of the fifth? Chamishi lechadoshim is the fifth month, Nisan i'asivan tamuz av. Tzoyim ha'shvi, what's the fast day of the seventh month, the Gimel Tishri, it's the third day of Tishri. Sheboi Ner Gedalia ben Achikom, the great tzaddik and the leader at the time of those few people that were allowed that the Goyim allowed to stay in Eretz Yisrael at the time after the Churban, was Gedalia ben Achikom, and Umi Horgoin, who killed him, Yishmoel ben Nesanya, a Yid, who killed him, Horgoi killed him, whether he got killed on the 3rd of Tishri or he got killed on Rosh Hashanah, but they only fasted on the 3rd of Tishri because the first 2 days of Tishri is Yom Tov of Rosh Hashanah, is a discussion. But Lelam Doch Sheshkulam Misoson Shel Tzadikim, the fact that this, the 3rd day of Tishri, is brought together with the other fast days here, so we see that the death of a tzaddik is equivalent to Kesreifas Beis Elokeinu, like the Beis Hamikdash being destroyed. V'amai kori le'shvi, why is it called the Tzoyim ha'shvi? Shvi lechadoshim is the seventh month from Nisan, is the month of Tishri. Tzoyim ha'asiri, what's the fast of the tenth? Zu asara b'teves, it's the tenth day of the tenth month of the year. Sheboi somach melech bobel el Yerushalayim, that the besiege on Yerushalayim began by the king of Bovel on Yerushalayim, began on the tenth of Teves. Hasara b'teves shenemer, as it says in the pasuk in Yecheskel, Vayhi dvar Hashem elai, Hashem told me, Bashono atshiis, in the ninth year, Bachodesh ha'asiri, in the tenth month, which is the month of Teves, Ba'oso lachodesh, lemer, on the tenth of the month, Hasara b'teves, tenth of the month, lemer is saying, as follows, says in the next pasuk, Ben Adam, Ksov locho es shem ayoim, es etzem ayoim hazeh, somach melech bovel el Yerushalayim. On this day, the king of Bovel started, he began to besiege Yerushalayim, be'etzem ayoim hazeh, on this day. And v'amai kori le'asiri, why is it called the fast of the tenth? Asiri lechadoshim, from Nisan, Teves is the tenth month. Now, if we would look in chronological order, what happened first? First, the besiege on Yerushalayim began, which was in the 10th of Teves. After that, there was a breach in the city, and that was in Tammuz. And after that, the Beit HaMikdash was burnt, and that was in Av. So the order is really, the Pasuk is mentioning the beginning of the besiege in Teves at the end of the Pasuk. This one should have been mentioned first, because it happened even before the Huvka Ha'ir, even before the city was breached. V'loma nichtav kan, why is it written at the end of the Pasuk? K'nei lehazdir chadoshim k'tikonon. In order, the Pasuk is going in the order of the months. First you've got Tammuz, then you've got Av, then you have Tishri, then you have Teves. Va'ani, that's how Rabbi Akiva understood. Va'ani and Ayrub Shimon, Eini Omer Kein, I say differently. So I agree with everything that was said here. That I agree with Rabbi Akiva on all the points, besides for this last one, the Tzoyim Asiri in Teves. He says the fast day in Teves that the Pasuk is referring to is not the 10th of Teves when the besiege began. No. El Tzoyim Asiri is a Chamisha b'Teves, it's the 5th of Teves. Sheboi bos Shmuel le'goyla, that's when the news of the Churban, after Tisha B'Av, after the 9th of Av, the Beis HaMikdash was destroyed, the Teves after that, on the 5th of Teves, the news arrived to the people in exile that the Beis HaMikdash had been destroyed, Shehuksa Ir, that the city of Yerushalayim had been smitten, Shenemer, as it says in the Pasuk, in Yechezkel, Vayhi b'shtei esrei shana, bo'asiri, in the 10th month, which is Teves, b'chamisha l'chodesh, in the 5th, on the 5th day of the month, l'galuseinu, bo'elai apolit m'Yerushalayim, the one who escaped from Yerushalayim, Lemer, came to tell us that Huksa Ha'ir, that Yerushalayim had been hit. Va'asu yem shmua, and this day where the news arrived in Chutz Laaretz, in the Golus, is kayem sreifa. It was compared, they made it like the day that got burnt. Tisha B'Av was the day the Beis HaMikdash got burnt, so the 5th of Teves after that became a day which was similar to the day of the sreifas Beis HaMikdash. V'nirin dvorai midvorov, and Reb Shimon says that the way I'm understanding what the Tzoyim Asiri is more probable than what my Rebbe Reb Akiva said. She'ani oimer al rishoin, because according to me, the first mentioned in the Pasuk, which is the one in Tammuz, the breach of the city, rishoin was the first that happened of all the things mentioned here. Val achrein, and the last one in the Pasuk, the 5th of Teves, is achrein, is the last thing that happened. It's when the news came to the Goyla. V'hu oimer, but my Rebbe Reb Akiva, he said al rishoin achrein, the first thing mentioned in the Pasuk, which is the besiege of the ear of the city, wasn't really the first thing. It was somewhere further down the line. It was the second thing that happened. Val achrein, and the very last thing mentioned in the Pasuk, according to Rebbe Akiva, which is when the besiege began, that's rishoin, that's what happened first, chronologically. And therefore, Reb Shimon says it's probable that the Pasuk means what I am saying and not what Reb Akiva was saying. Elo shehu mayinu l'seidu chadoshim. Reb Akiva only took into account the order of the months. V'ani oimer, but I also took into account l'seidu poronios, the order of the sequence of events as they happened, the tragedies as they befell us, in the right order. And Yemirtz Hashem, in the next shir, we're going to start the next sugya.